Good evening, everyone. I'm Susan Schoenberger. I'm the Director of Communications here at Hartford Seminary. And I apologize on behalf of Dr. Nakshivani. He actually was taken ill this afternoon, and so he won't be able to be with us tonight, and he sends his apologies. So that leaves me to introduce our speaker and to tell you that this is part of our series that is sponsored by the Imam Ali Chair for Shia Studies and Dialogue Among Islamic Legal Schools. So I know many of you have been here for some of the other talks that we've had in this series, and it's been a wonderful series. We've had some really outstanding scholars come in and speak to us, and I'm sure tonight will be one of those as well. I'm going to introduce to you Jonathan A.C. Brown, who is the Al-Walid bin Talal Chair of Islamic Civilization in the School of Foreign Service at Georgetown University. He is also the director of the Al-Walid bin Talal Center for Muslim-Christian Understanding. He received his BA in History from Georgetown University and his doctorate in Near Eastern Languages and Civilizations from the University of Chicago. Dr. Brown has studied and conducted research in Egypt, Syria, Turkey, Morocco, Saudi Arabia, Yemen, South Africa, India, Indonesia, and Iran. He has written many books, including Misquoting Muhammad, The Challenges and Choices of Interpreting the Prophet's Legacy, which was named one of the top books on religion for 2014 by The Independent. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Brown.
Thanks very much, everybody, for inviting me. I guess hopefully I'll see Sayyid Ammar later. Hopefully he gets better, inshallah. It's a pleasure to be back here. I think it's been a couple of years since I've been here, but I did recognize the place. I had the pleasure of the glorious autumn leaves, watching them as I came on the train. I felt like they were like scrubbing my spirit, the colors of the leaves. It's just so beautiful. And where I live, a little bit farther south, we're not, we don't get quite as many bright colors. So I was glad to come this time of year. So the topic of my lecture is something that I came across a couple of years ago when I was writing my book on Hadith. And it's something that interested me a lot, the phenomenon of kind of confessional ambiguity or overlap between Sunni and Shia traditions at the very place that you think it's least likely to find this, namely in the Sunni Hadith tradition, the tradition of Sunni Hadith scholarship, that was born out of the Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, the people of the Sunnah and Jama'ah, this school of thought which forms in the late 700s, the early 800s in the Hejaz and Iraq and Iran. One of its defining features is that it's very opposed to Shiite schools of thought. So when you find kind of overlap between Sunni and Shiite traditions in material or in style, it's very interesting to me. So the case of the Sahifa of Imam Ali Reda is an excellent case of that, and I want to discuss this, what I find to be a fascinating instance. I'm also going to use the Persian pronunciation. I'll just say Imam Reza instead of Ali Reda. So, because I like Reza, it sounds better than Reda. That's just my personal predilection. So what is the Sahifa of Imam Ali Reza? This is a collection of about 210 hadiths. I counted them on the train, so I might be a few off because, you know, the train's bumping up and down, but it's about 210 hadiths via an isnad, a chain of transmission from Imam Ali Reza, from his father, Musa al-Kadhim, from Ja'far al-Sadiq, from Muhammad al-Baqir, from Ali, Zain al-Abdin, from al-Hussein, from Ali ibn Abi Talib, from the Prophet, alayhi salam. So it goes back through the chain of Imams to the Prophet. And this collection of hadiths is the report is that it was transmitted by Imam Ali, Imam Reza, when he's passing through Qazvin, the city of Qazvin in northern Iran. And he's hiding there from his pursuers, and he's hiding in the house of one of his students named Dawood bin Sulaiman al-Ghazi, and he transmits these hadiths to him, and then this collection of hadiths then gets passed on in Qazvin. And the first place I read about this was when I was reading a book called Tadween fi Akhbar Qazvin. And this is a book by a famous Shafi'i scholar. His main fame is that he was a really important scholar of the Shafi'i school of law. And his name is Abdul Karim al-Rafi'i, who died in 1226 of the Common Era. So he's a scholar who's mainly a jurist in the Shafi'i school of law. But one of the things he decides to do on the side is write a history of his native city of Qazvin, which everybody knows is in northern Iran. As far as I remember, it's kind of in the foothills of the Elbors Mountains. And it's about, 2 hours from Tehran? If you're in a car, anybody? About 2 hours? And it would be on the road, basically, if you were on the Silk Road, let's say you were a merchant on the Silk Road from China all the way to the Middle East, or any of that part between, any place between those two places, if you were going from Nishapur, you'd pass through Ray, which is now Tehran, and then you'd go to Qazvin, and then you'd go to Hamadan, and then you'd go eventually to Baghdad. So these places are all on the same road. You can see why there's a lot of connection between them. So Rafi, in his history of Qazvin, he talks about how famous this hadith collection became, and that this stop made by Ali Reda became very, going against my own principle, Imam Reza, his stop in Qazvin becomes this famous moment in Qazvini history that he says, Ishtahara, became very well known in the city of Qazvin. So what's in this collection? About 210 hadiths. What type of material do we find in it, going back to the Prophet? There's about five different, grouped it into five different types of material. But one is, and this I think the predominant category, is what you might call generic, innocuous, pietistic material. What I mean is it's pietistic material that no one is going to find controversial, at least no Muslim would find controversial. For example, the Prophet saying, "Al-ilm khaza'in wa mafatihuha su'al." Knowledge is treasures and its keys are questions. Okay, that's, no one's going to get, that's a pretty basic principle, everyone can agree on that. Another one, إِيَّاكُمْ وَالْظُلْمُ فَإِنَّهُ يُخَرِّبُ قُلُوبُكُمْ. Beware of injustice because it destroys hearts. Everyone in the world can agree with that principle. Another one you find is things that appear in the Sunni tradition as well, as hadiths that are maybe not necessarily considered very reliable, but are very widespread. Like the hadith in which the Prophet says that whoever memorizes 40 hadiths for the Ummah will be resurrected amongst the scholars on the Day of Judgment. It's a very, very common hadith, which is behind the phenomenon of 40 hadith collections in the Sunni tradition. And then, of course, also in the Shiite tradition. For example, Ayatollah Khomeini has a famous book of 40 hadiths with his own full isnads all the way back to the Prophet. The second type you might consider pro-Ahlul Bayt material. But a lot of this is actually also found in the Sunni hadith collections. So, for example, the hadith of Thaqalain, where the Prophet says, "I've left amongst you two Thaqalain," which I've never really known how to translate, two weighty things, two heavy things, my sunnah and my family, my itrati. This you find in Sahih Muslim, one of the most respected Sunni hadith collections. What's called Hadith Safina, or Hadith Safinat Nuh, where the Prophet says that, indeed my family is like the Noah's Ark. Whoever gets in it, whoever reaches it basically, will be saved, and whoever misses it is going to perish. And this is also found in some Sunni Hadith collections like the Mustadrak of al-Hakam and Nisapuri, the Mu'jam of al-Tabarani. These are fairly well-respected Sunni Hadith collections. Another Hadith in the Sahifa of Ali Reza is the Hadith where the Prophet says, Fatima is a part of me, so whoever angers her has angered me, whoever pleases her has pleased me. And this Hadith you find in Sahih al-Bukhari. So this material is, it's very pro Ahlul Bayt, but it's also, it's within the realm of the way Sunnis talk about the Ahlul Bayt and the virtues and the favor of the family of the Prophet. You also find ones that I don't think I've seen in any Sunni collections, but I can easily imagine being in one, like a Hadith where the Prophet talks about the rewards you get if you visit the grave of Hussein, about Hussein. Okay. There's a third category is really pronounced material focusing on Fatima and Imam Hussein. And I didn't get a chance to check really thoroughly, but I don't think this appears in Sunni in mainstream Sunni collections, but I could be wrong. I don't want to make definitive statements about this. For example, one Hadith, the Prophet talks about how on the Day of Judgment, God will resurrect Fatima, and she will have with her a cloth that's soaked in the blood of her son, Hussein. And she'll go to the throne of God and ask God to pass judgment on between her and the person who killed her son. This is not anti-Sunni in the sense that when even a very doctrinaire, strict Sunni scholar like the famous Hadith scholar of Damascus in the 14th century, Shamsuddin al-Dhahabi, died 1348, he is no fan of Shiites. In fact, he's often called by Zaydi and Shiite authors, he's often called Nasibi, like kind of very hardcore Sunni. But when he talks about Hussein's death, I mean, this is a huge tragedy that no one can sort of deny the massive tragedy that this massacre represents. So even this Hadith, although I'm not sure you'd find in Sunni collections, it doesn't represent something that is inimical or anti-Sunni. There's other things that are again not anti-Sunni, but they're starting to get very more particular Shiite. For example, one Hadith in which the Prophet says that God has commanded Muslims to love four people, Ali, Salman al-Farisi, Abu Dhar al-Ghifari, and Miqdad al-Aswad, Miqdad ibn al-Aswad. So these are, Salman, Abu Dhar, and Miqdad ibn al-Aswad are the three companions of the Prophet who are the kind of the biggest defenders of Ali's claim to the caliphate, to leadership. So, this is, clearly rings with Shiite tones, but also, again, Sunnis wouldn't object to this because they'd say, well, these are all companions. So they're all just, they're all people you should admire. There's nothing wrong with singling these four people out. Then, interestingly, in the collection, there's also stuff that is sort of ambiguously pro-Sunni. And what I mean ambiguously is I think you could read it in two ways, kind of depending on how you see the world. One is the Prophet saying, "Man sabba nabiyyan kutila." وَمَنْ سَبَّ صَاحِبْ نَبِيٍّ جُلِّدَ. Whoever curses a prophet should be killed. Whoever curses the companion of a prophet should be lashed. Now, Sunnis would say, yes, yeah, we agree. That's what we've been saying the whole time, right? But it depends who you consider to be the companions of the prophet. Because in the Zaydi tradition or in the Imami Shia tradition, they have very specific definitions for who's this companion of the Prophet. For the Sunnis, after the main definition, which is provided by al-Bukhari in his Sahih, is that anybody who sees the Prophet and dies a Muslim is a companion of the Prophet. Whereas in the Shiite schools, there's a much more restrictive definition. So it kind of, whoever reads this, if they bring their own perspective to it, it's actually acceptable to them. The second one is, the Prophet saying, "Allahumma arham khulafai thalath marrat." Qila ya Rasulullah, "Man khulafak?" Qala alladhina ya'tuna min ba'di wa yarwuna hadithi وَسُنَّتِي وَيُعَلِّمُونَهَا. The Prophet says, O God, have mercy on my caliphs, or my successors. And he says this three times, and someone asks him, O Messenger of God, who are your successors, your caliphs? And he says, those people who come after me and narrate my hadiths and transmit my sunnah and teach it to people. So again, if you were a Sunni reading this, you'd say, yeah, this is really excellent. We completely agree. And if you were a Shiite, you would also say this is excellent, because you would simply have a different definition of who these successors are. Okay. So what you have is a collection that is it is highly ecumenical. It's either innocuously pietistic, or it's reverential to the family of the Prophet in the way that Sunnis would completely accept, or it's speaking about issues in such a vague way that people could read it either in through a Sunni light or a Shiite light. How is this the collection transmitted? Now, I have to say, I haven't done an exhaustive study on this collection, so I don't want to, I could be missing lots of things, and if I'm wrong about something and somebody knows about that, please correct me. And don't leave thinking that you've, you know, heard an encyclopedic presentation on this issue, because there's probably things I'm missing. What's interesting is that this collection is really tied to the city of Qazvin. It has a special relationship to the city of Qazvin, as far as I can tell. In Rafi's history of Qazvin, which is four volumes, it comes up over and over and over again. It's like, you know, I don't know what would be the good example in, you know, it's like being from Dublin and having to read Dubliners because, you know, in your fourth grade class or whatever the heck they call grades in Ireland. I mean, the idea is it's a book that's tied to your city. And people who go through the study of hadith and pietistic material in the madrasas of Qazvin in the 900s and 1000s and the 1100s of the Common Era, this collection of hadiths is something that they study and they hear as part of that process, that kind of acculturation into the world of Islamic knowledge, Sunni Islamic knowledge in Qazvin. So just for example, we have examples of it being heard and studied in the 900s, in the 1000s, even as the latest example I saw was in 1098 of the Common Era. It mentioned someone narrating this to students in one of the mosques of Qazvin. And then we know also that it goes to Baghdad. The famous scholar of Baghdad, al-Khatib al-Baghdadi, who died in 463 Hijri, 1071 of the Common Era. Khatib al-Baghdadi is, a lot of people just know him from his history of Baghdad, but his main vocation was a hadith scholar. He was a Shafi hadith scholar who followed the Ash'ari school of theology and was very Sunni. And but in his history of Baghdad, he mentions that the collection of Imam Ali Reza was brought to Baghdad in the year 318 Hijri, which is about 928-929 of the Common Era. And it was brought there by someone named Ibn Mahruway from Qazvin, who was the student of Dawood bin Suleiman al-Ghazi. And so he brings this to the city of Baghdad in 318 of the Hijri, about 923 of the Common Era. Sorry, about 928 of the Common Era. And what's interesting is that al-Khatib al-Baghdadi considers this figure, Ibn Mahruway, who is the main transmitter of the Sahifa of Ali Reza, he considers him to be reliable. He says he's a reliable transmitter. Mahalluhu Siddiq, he says. He's a reliable transmitter. And something else that he mentions about him, which is something I'll get into later, is that he also brought material from a very important and respected hadith scholar of Ray, named Ibn Abi Hatim al-Razi. Ibn Abi Hatim al-Razi was a very important hadith scholar who died in the year 927 Hijri, about, 327 Hijri, 938 of the Common Era. And he is one of the most important figures in Sunni hadith transmission and the sciences of Sunni hadith criticism. His father was a scholar named Abu Hatim al-Razi, and his father and his father's best friend, Abu Zurra al-Razi, were the two biggest hadith scholars, Sunni hadith scholars of Ray in the late 800s of the Common Era. And they were really formative Sunni hadith critics. So Ibn Abi Hatim al-Razi is like a clearinghouse for really important material from the Sunni hadith tradition. And what's interesting is Ibn Mahrawi, when he comes to Baghdad, not only is he bringing the Nuskha or the Sahifa of Ali Reza, he's also bringing lots of the books of Ibn Abi Hatim al-Razi. Another thing I noticed, and I'm not sure if this is a different book, because the only published edition of the Sahifa of Ali Reza that I've found is published in, it's basically from the Zaydi tradition. So I don't know if the version that was in Qazvin is the same version as the one from Yemen, or if it's two different versions, or if it's the same book. But there's another, it could be the same book, but there's another transmission of this book that goes back through Zaydi scholars of Yemen, and eventually to the famous Sunni scholar of Damascus, Ibn Asakir. Ibn Asakir died in 1176 of the Common Era. He wrote the famous History of Damascus, which is 80 volumes, published in 80 volumes. It's not as big as Bihar al-Anwar, which is 100 volumes, but it's pretty big, 80 volumes. And then it goes back to another famous Sunni scholar from northern Iran, Bayhaqi. Bayhaqi's from Bayhaq, which is now Sabzavar, which is about halfway between Tehran and Khorasan, like Nishapur area, So it goes back through these to northern Iran, but then instead of going to Qazvin, it goes back to Basra. So someone transmitted this from Imam Ali Reda and then went to Basra instead of staying in Qazvin. Okay, how do we explain this this book and its popularity amongst Sunni scholars in northern Iran, especially in the city of Qazvin? Well, what was Qazvin sort of a particularly sensitive, relaxed place or something like that? No, I don't think so. I think Qazvin was a very Sunni place. I think that's my impression. In fact, and of course this is many centuries later, but when the Safavid dynasty takes over Iran in the early 1500s, Qazvin is the single most powerful stronghold of Sunnism in Iran, in Persia. And in fact, the Safavid dynasty basically has to make kind of a truce with the Sunni scholars of Qazvin and basically say that they can stay Sunni, they don't have to convert Shi'ism, but they can't be too public about their teachings. And one of the, when the Ottomans and the Safavids had their peace treaty, the battle of, after the treaty of Amasya, I think in 1055, one of the conditions of the treaty is that the Safavids have to relax their treatment of the Sunni scholars in Qazvin. So I think it's interesting to think about Qazvin as sort of a historical stronghold of Sunnism in Iran, even after it comes under Shiite control with the Safavid dynasty. But I think even in the Qazvin in the 900s and 1000s of the Common Era, I think there's a very clear strong Sunni bent. And here's a good example. A scholar in Qazvin writes a book on the Fadal of Muawiyah, the virtues of Muawiyah. Not a lot of people write books on the virtues of Muawiyah, even in Sunni Islam. I mean, the famous North African scholar, or Iberian scholar, Qadi Abu Bakr ibn al-Arabi, who dies around 1146 of the Common Era, around 1146, when he goes to Baghdad and he studies with Abu Hamid al-Ghazali in Baghdad, and he's very Sunni. His book, Al-Awasim and Al-Kawasim, it's like a short guidebook to being really, really hardcore, proud Sunni. And one of the things he mentions is he says when he went to, he remembers reading over the doors of one of the mosques of Baghdad that it said, it praised the four caliphs, the four rightly guided caliphs, and then added Muawiyah after them. So it's not like Sunnis are throwing Muawiyah under the bus, right, left, and center, But to sit and actually devote a book to Fada al-Muawiyah is, in my to my knowledge, very rare, even for Sunnis. But someone in Qazvin, one of the scholars, writes a book on Fada al-Muawiyah. If you lived in Damascus, for example, in the 700s or 800s, then I could see somebody writing Fada al-Muawiyah. I mean, the only place, even today in the Muslim world, you find people named Yazid would be in, like, the Syria, Sham area of Syria. This is my experience. That's the case even centuries and centuries ago. One of the few people you'll find who is named Yazid in the Sunni tradition is Muhammad ibn Yazid ibn Majah, died 876 of the Common Era. Ibn Majah, one of the authors of the author of one of the Sunni canonical Sunni collections of Hadith, Sunan ibn Majah, who was from Qazvin. So Muhammad ibn Yazid ibn Majah is from Qazvin, again, kind of a product of a city that I think was a very Sunni place. But what's interesting is that there's also other material transmitted in Qazvin that goes back to Imam Ali Reza. For example, the will that the Caliph al-Ma'mun wrote, where he specified Ali Reza as his successor. Anybody who studied Islamic history knows that the Caliph al-Ma'mun at a certain point actually designates Ali Reza as his successor, and then Imam Ali Reza is murdered, in effect. He's in the entourage of al-Ma'mun, and he dies under very suspicious circumstances while traveling with him in near what becomes the city of Tus. But what's interesting, so that will is transmitted like hadiths in the mosque, which is very interesting. It's this historical document that's actually transmitted as hadiths are transmitted for pietistic purposes, not for legal purposes. No one's deriving law from the will of al-Ma'mun to Ali Reza. It's transmitted for the purposes of barakah. Another thing that gets transmitted in connection to the Sahifa of Ali Reza is the Wasiyat Ali, the Wasiyah of Ali ibn Abi Talib. I'm not sure what that is. I'm sure that other people know what it is, but it's the kind of last will and testament of Ali ibn Abi Talib. So this is also transmitted in Qazvin by Sunnis alongside the Sahifa of Ali Reza. So, how do we explain this? How do we explain the fact that this material is being transmitted in a very, very Sunni city? And it seems to really begin there and flourish there, even though it goes to other parts of the Muslim world. I mean, I think the answer is given to us in a story that's also in the history of Qazvin of Arafiri. Ibn Mahraway, the transmitter of the Sahih of Ali Reza, tells a story that Ibn Abi Hatim al-Razi heard from his father. So again, we have this connection between the Sahih of Ali Reza and Ibn Abi Hatim al-Razi, who's again, very important figure in Sunni Hadith criticism. Ibn Abi Hatim al-Razi hears from his father, Abu Hatim al-Razi, another huge scholar, Sunni scholar, that if you read لَوْ قُرِيَ هَذَا الْإِسْنَادِ عَلَى مَجْنُونَ لَأَفَاقُ. What does that mean? If somebody is afflicted with some kind of madness or epilepsy or a seizure, and you read the isnad of Ali Reza back through his forefathers to the Prophet, if you read that isnad, that chain of transmission, out over this person, it will heal them. And Ibn Abi Hatim Razi says that this actually happens. So he's walking down the street and some guy collapses in a fit, in a seizure. And he reads the isnad out over this person and he recovers. So what do we see here? This is the barakah, the blessing of this isnad, of the family of the Prophet. It's able to heal these people. So this is a story that is passed down by Ibn Abi Hatim al-Razi, from his father, Abu Hatim al-Razi, And this then gets tacked on to, or is associated with, the Sahifa of Ali Reza. Just to give you an example of how kind of shocking this might be, Abu Hatim Razi, the father of Ibn Abi Hatim Razi, and his best friend Abu Zura Razi. Abu Zura Razi is the one who says, if you hear anybody speak ill of a companion of the Prophet, that person is zindiq. That means they're a heretic. So that's actually one of the authoritative statements in Sunni books of hadith criticism when you want to know how to judge someone speaking ill of one of the companions of the Prophet, is they'll cite this statement by Abu Zur al-Razi that if someone says something negative about one of the companions of the Prophet, that person is a heretic. So the same social circle that produces that statement by Abu Zur al-Razi also produces Ibn Abi Hatim al-Razi's statement about reading the isnad of the Imam Ali Reza's hadith out over a sick person can heal them. And there's not a contradiction here. There's not a contradiction here. Because even if you are a very doctrinaire Sunni who thinks that it is absolutely unacceptable to speak ill of any of the family, any of the companions of the Prophet, you can still believe in the tremendous barakah of the family of the Prophet. These things are not inconsistent. And it seems clear to me that in the context of Qazvin, from the 900s, to the 1000s, to the 1100s, and in other places where the Sahifa of Ali Reza is transmitted, it's the barakah of the family of the Prophet that is what is endearing this to the Sunni scholarly circles that transmit it. But this raises another interesting point, which is that even the very strict Sunni hadith scholars of the Khorasan region, of northern Iran and Khorasan, so Ray and then over into the Khorasan province, which back then would have been based around four different cities, Naishapur, Herat, Marv, and Balkh. So today it goes between northeastern Iran into Afghanistan, a little bit of Uzbekistan, and Turkmenistan. That region, the Sunni hadith tradition there was very strongly oriented towards the family of the Prophet. Very strongly oriented towards the family of the Prophet. Just as some examples, al-Hakim al-Naysapuri, he's a famous Sunni hadith scholar who died in 1015 of the Common Era from Nishapur. He writes a book called the Mustadrak, which is a collection of hadiths that he claims meets the critical criteria of al-Bukhari and Muslim. So it becomes a very influential hadith collection in Sunni Islam. Although there's a lot of disagreement about whether actually he's a very good hadith critic, it's a very respected collection. That's the collection where you find things like hadith where the Prophet says, looking at Ali is a type of worship, another Ali ibadah, which a lot of Sunni scholars like Ibn al-Jawzi and Dhahabi don't accept. They think that hadith is false. But al-Hakim al-Naysapuri says, no, this hadith is authentic up to the standards of Bukhari and Muslim. It's also not surprising that Hakim Naysapuri is accused by some of being Shiite, of having Shiite leanings. Because one of the hadiths he also includes in his collection is the hadith of Ghadir Khum, the instance in which the Prophet says that to his followers that whoever's master I am, then Ali is his master. Even when we go back to the compilers of the six books, the famous Sunni canonical hadith collections, Bukhari, in his section in his Sahih on the virtues of the companions of the Prophet, he has a section on Muawiyah, but there's no real reports, there's no reports from the Prophet about Muawiyah. It's just Ibn Abbas, the companion of the Prophet, saying, basically saying that Muawiyah was a faqih, that he had good knowledge of Islamic teachings. But of course, the other chapters have the Prophet himself, alayhi salam, praising the companion who's the subject of that chapter. And Sahih Muslim does not have a section on Muawiyah. In addition, Nasa'i, Ahmed bin Shu'ayb al-Nasa'i, who's from Nasa, which is also on that same road in Khorasan, kind of between around the Nishapur area. He traveled, like all these other scholars, traveled widely, and he went to Damascus. And in Damascus, he saw that people were negatively disposed towards Ali. And so he wrote a book called Khasa'is Ali, the special virtues of Ali ibn Abi Talib. And people in Damascus got upset at him and said, why don't you write a book on the virtues of Muawiyah? And he said, what am I going to put in the book that the Prophet said, Allahumma la tushbi' batnahu? God let, so Muawiyah is one of the Prophet's scribes, and the story is, this hadith is in Sahih Muslim, that the Prophet tells someone, go get Muawiyah so he can come and write something for me. And Muawiyah says, I'm eating. And sends him again, Muawiyah says, I'm eating. And sends him again, and then the Prophet gets upset. He says, you know, may God never make his stomach full. So the story is, Nasa'i is saying that, what am I going to put in the book of the virtues of Muawiyah? This story about him not, you know, the Prophet saying this. And actually, one of the reports about the way that Nasa'i died is that he was beaten to death by people who were upset in Damascus, people who were upset that he had written this book on the virtues of Ali and wouldn't write one on the virtues of Muawiyah. But that story is disputed. It's unclear exactly how he died. I mean, sorry, I should have given this example earlier, but this, also in the Mustadrak of al-Hakam in Naysapuri, he has a story of Marwan ibn al-Hakam being brought to the Prophet as a child, and the Prophet calling him Mal'un ibn Mal'un. This is a cursed person who's the son of a cursed person, because the Prophet had also expelled Marwan's father al-Hakam. He had expelled him from Medina, and he was here saying even this Marwan is also cursed person. So then, al-Hakam ibn Naysapuri is a Sunni hadith scholar. Despite accusations he's Shia, he's a Sunni hadith scholar. All these people I mentioned are Sunni hadith scholars. They're major Sunni hadith scholars. But the hadith scholarship, the Sunni scholarship of the Khorasan region in the 800s and then early 900s, had a strong leaning towards the family of the Prophet. Okay. Just another, before I wrap up, another example of collections through isnads of the Ahlul Bayt in the Sunni tradition, and the kind of the mixed feelings that get generated around them. You know, people in places other than Qazvin, you know, you see this tension between a desire to respect the family of the Prophet and appreciate what might be useful hadith material, and then this sense that maybe this is a forgery, this is some kind of Shiite forgery. Al-Khatib al-Baghdadi, I mentioned him earlier, the famous hadith scholar of Baghdad, he says that in 311 Hijri, or that's about 922 of the Common Era, a scholar who's an Alid, so he's descended from Ali ibn Abi Talib, named al-Qasim bin Ja'far al-Alawi, he comes from the Hijaz, and he brings with him a nuskha, a hadith collection, via a chain of transmission by his ancestors to Ali ibn Abi Talib, to the Prophet. And Khatib Baghdadi says, the majority of the stuff, aktharuhu min akir. What that means is, most of the material in it is rejected material. But the example he gives of this rejected material is interesting. It's a story of Ali ibn Abi Talib saying that the Prophet, he says, Da'ani Rasulullah liyasta'milani ala al-Yaman. The Prophet of God called me and said, I want to put you in charge of Yemen. I'm going to send you to make you the administrator and the judge in Yemen. The Persian governor of Yemen converted to Islam in 628 of the Common Era, and he handed the province over to the Muslim movement. So even 4 years before the death of the Prophet, Yemen had become a part of the Muslim polity. So Ali says to the Prophet, according to the story, that he said, I'm young and I don't know al-qadha, I don't know how to be a judge. And the Prophet hits him twice on the chest like this, and then Ali says, and I quote, it was as if all knowledge was mine, kullu ilmin 'indi, and my heart was stuffed with knowledge and with fiqh, so that I never had any doubt judging between two people. So that's the story that Khatib Baghdadi gives as an example of the material that he finds unacceptable or unreliable in this other collection of hadiths via a chain of transmission from the family of the Prophet. But what's interesting about this is that's actually not that unusual in the Sunni tradition. In the Hilyat al-Awliya of Abu Naim al-Isbahani, one of Khatib Baghdadi's teachers, a famous Shafi Ashari scholar from Isfahan, and a great Sufi and great hadith collector, who died in 1038 of the Common Era, Abu Naim al-Isbahani. There's a story of Kumail ibn Ziyad, the companion of Ali ibn Abi Talib, saying that Ali said to him, his teacher, إِنَ هَهُنَا عُلُومًا جَمَّةً لَوْ وَجَدْتُ لَهَا حَمَلًا. Indeed, in here is strong knowledge. I wish, if only I could find people to transmit it from me. So this idea that of the esoteric transmission of knowledge is actually found in the Sunni tradition, especially in the Sufi tradition, in the Sufi chains of Sunni Islam. An example of this is a story which apparently was pretty widespread in Cairo in the 1300s, because a Sunni scholar named Azarkashi, Bedruddin Azarkashi, who died about 1394 of the Common Era, he includes this story as a story that is he hears on the streets, but he doesn't consider it to be authentic. But it's interesting that it's making rounds on the streets of a very Sunni city of Cairo. This is a story that Ali ibn Abi Talib tells, that when he was washing the body of the Prophet, after the death of the Prophet, water had splashed from his body into Ali's eye. And he said, when that water hit me in the eye, it gave me all the ilm al-awwaleen wal-akhareen, all the knowledge of the latter day and the early and the latter day sages. It's like all the knowledge of the world was transmitted into him by the water from the Prophet's body. So this is something that's not uncommon in the Sunni tradition. Of course, some scholars consider the Sahifa of Ali Reda to be a total forgery. The most vocal was the famous Sunni scholar of Damascus, Shamsuddin al-Dhahabi. I already mentioned him, who died in 1348. What he says is that the student of Ali Reza, Suleiman, Dawood bin Suleiman al-Ghazi, he made this up completely, and just he forged it and attributed it to Ali Reda. Just as a last point, I want to say that I don't think that the Sahifa of Ali Reza is the only locus of this overlap between Sunni and Shiite material and modes of speaking that in the medieval period. And I'm not even talking about, a lot of times people speak about the age of confessional ambiguity in the 1200s and 1300s, when it's very hard to tell who's Sunni and who's Shiite in Iran and Iraq. That's not even what I'm talking about. When you're in the 1000s in Baghdad or Qazvin, it's very easy to tell who's Sunni and who's Shiite. This is not a period of confessional ambiguity. This is a period in which lines are drawn very sharply. Very sharply. And Sunnis know exactly who a Sunni is and exactly what you have to do to be Sunni. And if you don't do those things, you're not Sunni. So this is not a period of ambiguity. But in that period, you nonetheless find these instances of overlap. And the other one I just wanted to bring up is, because I wrote an article about it, is the case of Abu Abbas ibn Uqda, who's a scholar, a hadith scholar from Kufa. He died in 332 Hijri, 944 of the Common Era. He is considered to be an authority in hadith in the Sunni tradition, in the Imami Shia tradition, and in the Zaydi tradition. So three traditions that spent a lot of time arguing each other and hating each other actually all looked at this guy as a hadith authority. He was he's not living in the late 700s or the early 700s when it wasn't clear who's Sunni and who's Shiite and none of these traditions had fully formed. This guy is living in the early 900s when it was very clear what Sunni Islam was, what Shiite Islam was. He was a Shiite. No one had any debate over that, had any doubt over that. But he was such an expert in Hadith criticism that not only was he considered to be a reliable Hadith transmitter, he was considered to be a reliable Hadith critic. This is the only instance I've ever found of this. When you have someone who's a pronounced, public, clear Shiite, but in all the books of Sunni Hadith criticism, even in the 1300s and 1400s, people like a Dhahabi, who's a very, very strict Sunni, will say, this scholar is, I quote, one of the Hadith masters and an oceanic body of knowledge in Hadith. So you still, it's interesting, even in the science, the Sunni science that is the most Sunni, the most perhaps hostile to Shiite ideas, namely the Sunni Hadith tradition, you still find instances like the Sahifa of Ali Reza and the respect for Ibn Uqta, where there is actually kind of ecumenical overlap between the two traditions. Thanks very much. So now I'm actually going to be in charge of the questions. I hope they're questions. Otherwise, well, it's just going to be awkward. What can I say? Yes. You want to hear about myself?
Yeah.
About me? I mean, I'm a Leo. I'm.
I think I have a couple of questions. Did you actually travel to Tehran?
Oh yeah. I went to. I mean, that's not where I learned about this. I would have, but I went to. I spent a couple of months in Iran in 2004. Studying Persian. My Persian was actually, it still is pretty good, but it was very good back then. And I stayed in Tehran, and I went all around the country. I went to, you know, Yazd and Isfahan and Shiraz and Rasht, and I spent a lot of time in Khorasan. I went to places that probably most Iranians don't care about, because I was there. For me, they're really important, because some scholar from the, like, I went to Esfahan, which I don't think most Iranians go to. I went to Juvain, which is this little village in the hills, but that's where Imam al-Haramain and Juvaini was from, so I wanted to go there. So I had a terrific visit. I really enjoyed it. It was the most fun trip I ever went on, and I really I loved being in Iran, and I would love to go back. I you know, it's sort of hard to get a visa. I think I could probably get a visa, inshallah, but I mean, now mostly it's just getting, you know, scheduling it, and we have like little kids and stuff. But I would love to go and spend, you know, as long as I could there. I really enjoyed it. Yes?
When you start the speech, as opposed to white American, then you say something Persian. I was thinking your ancestors, at least your aunt, your uncle. Is there any relationship with family?
One, I love the color of your suit. That is a great, no, your suit, it's a great color. But so I just realized that's a mistake, because I remember I once told that to an Iranian guy and he tried to give me his clothing. I'm just complimenting you on your taste. No need to offer the suit. No, I'm a white American guy, in the sense that my ancestors come from God knows where, but not Iran, as far as I know. They're all from England and Scotland and Russia and weird places like that. This is going to be an ego massage session. Why about you ask hard questions and make me feel bad? Yes?
So one question is, you put a recent article about how Muslims tolerated behavior that was forbidden in Islam. And I was just wondering what kind of feedback you got as a result of the article. I read the article, I looked for the comments under it. I didn't see any comments.
Wow, you read that. That's
yes,
just, I'm happy.
Happy
to hear when you wrote that. Read
right.
That.
So I'm wondering what kind of feedback.
So the story about that article is, I was telling Maike about this, but you know, since I'm, I guess, no longer a junior faculty, and I have more luxury about how I produce my research, in the last couple of years it became very clear to me, and this is not some kind of profound recognition on my part, but that, you know, it was important to write for Muslim audiences a lot more, for public Muslim audiences, considering a lot of the issues that Muslims face. And so it was really about the issue of gay marriage. This was, I think, it was the Orlando shooting. And I had been asked to write because someone, a Muslim, very capable, respected Muslim scholar was on the radio, and I mean, this is the kind of stuff now that Muslims face in terms of Islamophobia. Someone called in and asked, well, this Orlando shooter, why was what he did wrong in Islam? Because the Prophet says that whoever commits the crime of the people of Lot should be killed. So why, this guy who went into the club, he was just doing his Sharia duty. And the Muslim who was, you know, was just like, how do I deal with this? I mean, this is, someone asked me, like, someone, you have to write about this because this is seems like a big issue. So I wrote about that, and I sort of talked about the Sharia positions on rule of law and against vigilantism, and even if someone commits a sin, it's only the Sultan or the Wali al-Amr has the right to carry out the punishment, et cetera, et cetera. And then I talked about the fact that Muslims and Islamic civilization had, for centuries and centuries and centuries, going back to the time of the Prophet, had allowed people to engage in conduct and retain beliefs that were reprehensible to Muslims, and that Muslims could have easily stamped out. Muslims could have easily said, you can't do this, you can't believe that. But they allowed them to continue. And so this was sort of in along the lines of arguing that Muslims in America, you know, how do we position ourselves regarding other groups or other people in our society who believe in things or engage in lifestyles that we find reprehensible? How do we do it? And I said, you know, if Muslims who were in a position of power and who could have ended these practices, if they allowed them, then a fortiori, we who are not in a position of authority, who are just one group amongst many and an embattled and disliked minority at that, we're in no position to, it is no problem for us to acknowledge the right of other people to engage in actions that we consider to be reprehensible. And then I got very interested in the question of sati, of Hindu widow immolation.
Widow burning.
Yeah, exactly. And also of Zoroastrian incestuous marriage, what's called the hutade. It's, God knows how Pahlavi is pronounced, you know, how Pahlavi Persian was pronounced, but in the way I would read it in Persian, is hutade marriage, which was a Zoroastrian marriage between siblings or mother, son, father, daughter marriage, which was allowed in Zoroastrianism until the 1300s. So I was interested in this because in both cases, these are things that not only did Muslims consider them reprehensible, but every society, as far as I know in human history, considers immediate family interest, incest, to be taboo, to be unacceptable. And the widow immolation was something that Americans and British and Americans really didn't like. I mean, when you sort of, if you go to, you look at a Supreme Court cases like the, forget the name of the case, I'm forgetting it now, the 18 Davis case in 1890 and the 1878 case on freedom of religion that introduces that allows the government to prohibit certain practices. It's about polygamy. But the Supreme Court justice who's writing in that case uses the example of Hindu wife, of sati, as something that the government should be able to prohibit even though it's in someone else's religion. So what I was trying to say is that here are two things that in the West we consider so reprehensible that we actually outlaw, even if someone believes in it as part of their religion. Muslims didn't do that. Muslim rulers in India from the 1300s to the 1800s allowed Hindu widows, if they wanted to throw themselves on the fire of their husband, of their late husband, or burn themselves, if they came and got permission from the governor or from the emperor, so it was clear that they were not being forced into it, they said, you can go do this. This is your religion. They would try and convince them not to. They would offer them stipends. They would say, we'll take care of your children. Don't worry. But if the widow wanted to throw herself on the fire, the Muslim ruler said, it's your religion. You can do that. And when it came, so in India, this was actually You know, Muslims were a minority. At most, they're a quarter of the population of India. And so part of it is it's clear they don't want to mess too much with the local people's religion because they're afraid of, you know, they don't want to get too much pushback from the local population. But in the case of Zoroastrian incest marriage, this is, it's almost like a theoretical question because it's so uncommon. It's just like this, it's a thing that exists almost just on paper. Muslims could easily have said this is unacceptable, but they still allowed it. At least the majority position in Sunni Islam is they still allowed it, even though they could have said, they would have faced no repercussions had they banned it. But for them, they said, if you allow people to continue to believe in a religion you know is false, if there's someone who denies the prophethood of Muhammad, who denies the existence of God, if you're allowing them to continue that, that is much worse than allowing them to marry their sister. So if you're allowing this really severe continuation of disbelief, you, by the rule of excluded middle or whatever, you have to continue to allow them to engage in social practices that are reprehensible to you. Oh, yeah, sorry, I hope that was all interesting. I mean, I think it's interesting. The first article I wrote, Ya Salam, I almost got, carpal tunnel syndrome from this because first of all, I think actually a lot of Muslims in America were supportive. My impression is, and I haven't done any kind of polling on this, but my experience with Muslim leaders in the U.S. is that, if I'm wrong, someone please correct me, but my impression is that there seems to be a jumhur opinion, not a consensus, but a jumhur opinion that regarding gay marriage, that Muslims should support the right of gays to marry, in the sense that we support the right of any community to have a definition of marriage that is not defined by Christian cultural tradition. Why do we support that? Because that's exactly what Muslims want. My marriage, which is a Sharia marriage, okay? My marriage is just as reprehensible to the Anglo-British legal tradition and Anglo-British culture. It is just as reprehensible as gay marriages. When you go in common law, and actually here America is actually more advanced than Britain, up into the early, through the early 20th century, through the 1940s and 50s, in British law, a marriage that was a Sharia marriage that was not valid in Britain, if it was conducted in Britain. Why? Because there was a possibility, there was just the potential of polygamy. You don't have to have a polygamous marriage. If there's a potential of polygamy, it's invalid. That was the rule of British law. Then they basically started making an exception for Muslims based on the exception they'd made for Jews, et cetera, et cetera. But my point is that our marriage as Muslims is just as reprehensible to kind of conservative Christian views in this country as gay marriage is. And if I take the side of kind of conservative Christians and against the gay community, I'm next in line, as far as I can tell. Now, so on the position of, that was what I was arguing with regarding gay marriage. And basically I was trying to make an Islamic argument for that. Now, a lot of people in the US, I didn't get a lot of pushback or negative reaction from people in the US. I got a lot of negative reaction from especially like more conservative Muslims in Europe and the Muslim world who found what I was saying to be totally unacceptable. And by the way, I understand their argument. I mean, they're not naive either. They said things like, you're stupid if you think that it's gonna stop at this. It's not gonna be enough for you to defend the rights of LGBTQ couples to marry. The next thing is you're gonna be required to morally approve of what they're doing. And I agree with those people that is going to be asked, that's already being asked of the Muslim community, it's going to be asked more. And at that point, I mean, I would say, I will now stand for my religious right, which is that I do not, it is interfering with my right of, right to free exercise of my religion and to my right of conscience to say that I have to change my moral opinion and my religious opinion based on social concerns. I'm not interfering with anyone that was right. I'm not teaching hate. I'm not teaching someone to be violent or disrespectful to people. I'm simply continuing what my religion says is a sin versus not a sin.
Thank you.
Yes. So remember the a lot of the main buildings around at the shrine of Ali Reza were built by Sunnis, like Gohar Shah, the pavilion of Gohar Shah, I think she was the wife of Tamerlane or the daughter of the daughter-in-law of Tamerlane. So yeah, you're completely right. These were you know, like the mosque by Hussein in Cairo. The shrine or the burial places of families of descendants of the Prophet are just as much places of barakah for Sunnis as they are for Shiites. Of course, once you add a big dose of sectarianism in there, then the things start changing. So now, you know, if you talk about the shrine of Ali Reza in the context of Sunni Shiite issues in the Middle East, you know, oh, well, that's a Shiite place, and they're trying to make it like the Shiite Mecca, and that's, you know, they're saying people should go there instead of the Hajj and all this kind of stuff like that. So now, you know, it becomes much more politicized. But you're completely right that for many centuries, this was a location of one of the descendants of the Prophet that was venerated by Sunnis and Shiites alike. Yes, Osman. I could say that talking about the Sahifa of Ali Reza was going to solve all the problems in the world. It's not. I can just tell you from my personal position. I don't tolerate sectarianism. I mean, I don't. I will not. I'm not going down. I won't. Will never go down that road. It's horribly destructive, and what the kind of damage and destruction that it creates is, you know, has few peers, few parallels. So, you know, when I think for me it's, you know, kind of personal because, you know, when I was in college, I became Muslim when I was beginning my sophomore year. One of my best friend is a Shiite. His name is, I mean, I'm not doing the whole thing, my best friend is black thing. I'm not doing that. I'm not using this to defend anything. I'm just saying that, you know, when I was in my most formative time as a Muslim, my best friend is a Pakistani Shiite guy. He's not the best Muslim. He wouldn't mind me saying that. But he's a really Shiite. Even though he's not the best Muslim, he really loves the family of the Prophet. And he, you know, I would sit with him and, you know, we would talk about this, what it meant to him, and we would listen to qawwalis about the family of the Prophet. And so I think for me, I really started to, I got kind of an interior feel for what this meant to him and to his family. And that always stuck with me. And I would never deny that in someone else. And this idea that Imami Shiites are kuffar is just, I don't have any tolerance for that personally. And I don't care. If someone else wants to, if someone who's Shiite wants a bad mouth Sunni Muslim, like, I mean, sort of indifferent to that. I decided I don't really care about history. I mean, if you want to bring up, I was on this panel actually last year at GW, George Washington University, and it was on Sunni Shiite relations. And I gave this lecture where I basically said that, you know, the history is so rich that you can you can go back into history and kind of build whatever path forward you want. If you want to make a productive path forward where people live together sensibly, you can find that those building blocks to build that. If you want to build a path forward in the future of rancor and internecine strife, you can find those bricks too and build that path. And what really upset me was the first question in the audience was from an Iraqi Shiite who basically just said, well, what about all the ABC horrible things Sunnis did in the 1000s? And I said, didn't you listen to what I was just saying? I got really angry. I mean, I was one of the few times I've really gotten PO'd in a question and answer session. But I said, what I just said is, there is no point. If Sunnis did horrible stuff in the 1000s, okay, I, on behalf of Sunnis, apologize. Is that better? I mean, what's the point? Why allow that to dictate the future? So, I mean, my policy is if someone wants to, I don't deny the Shiite narrative of the past. And by the way, I don't deny that because I see Sunni Islam historically, not as an aqidah, but Sunni Islam as a history, as a sort of a realistic history. It's like, it's history with all the nastiness in it. It's like, it's like the American politics. It's just, there's ugly stuff, there's injustice, there's horrible compromises, there's people getting assassinated, the good guys don't win, the bad guys win, et cetera, et cetera. And that's like human history. It's the history that you learn to live with and that you recognize as the reality that you have to deal with. But I also see, for me, Shiite history is just as real. It's this history of oppression, of the people who are worthy being killed, the people who are standing up for truth being killed, the people who are standing up against oppressors who didn't have legitimacy being killed. And that's, when I see, you can see that today. You can see people standing up for truth and then they're next second they're dead in a ditch and no one even cares. And I mean, so I think both visions of history are very real to me, at least the way I see the world. And I don't see why they're not mutually contradictory to me. They're two sides of a coin of human experience. And I benefit from both. I think they both bring an aspect of truth to me. Yes, in the back. That's an interesting question. I mean, the question was how can an intra-faith model be centered, developed around Hadith? I don't know. I'm like very skeptical. I don't think that intra-faith discussions happen through scripture. I think they happen through people making almost kind of political decisions, internal political decisions. I mean, and by the way, I think this is actually, you see this in the Sunni tradition. I mean, the fact that one of the opinions of Ahmed ibn Hanbal is that Sunnis can pray behind Shiites. Like, you can pray behind a Shiite leader. And either you have to redo your prayer or you don't. It's unclear based on his opinions, because he has several opinions on this issue. But this is, I think, one of the most valuable contributions of the Sunni tradition, is that you can't demand total agreement. And you might really, really hate somebody and you might despise them and you might disagree with them on everything you think is important, but you're gonna stand next to them and pray in the same mosque and you're gonna even pray behind them. And that's something, for example, I hate the Egyptian government, the current Egyptian government. I consider it to be like an abomination in the face of the earth in terms of justice, in terms of aesthetics, the Sisi regime. But as a Sunni, I understand that if Sisi was leading the prayer, I would pray behind him. And that's so, I'm not even Egyptian, but that's so hard for me to stomach. But that's, I think, one of the strength of the Sunni tradition, is that it's really this forced compromise with reality. And I think that kind of, for intra-faith agreement to happen, it has to, I mean, it's sort of like Republicans, Democrats saying, you know, we really dislike each other and we disagree profoundly about the direction of the country, but we have to get together to pass this bill on spending or something like that. It's just sort of, people have to make a decision about accepting disagreement and still seeing common identity. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. We really enjoyed it. In regard to following the imam or leaders, in Shia, we follow only those who are alim and alim. This is what I understand. If we follow someone whom we know that he is not either alim or alim, we are confirming lack of ilm and lack of alim. That is why not only in non-interested during the prayers, but in social gatherings, we always against lack of and ulul, and also we love to eliminate the jahl or ignorance. So that is symbolic. The reason we don't follow, because we respect the ilm, knowledge, and adult. What do you think? Isn't it hypocrisy to some extent if you just follow everyone?
I think,
because,
you know,
brothers,
yeah, I mean, I think that's a, so, you know, what you, I think what you're asking is very much kind of following up on what I just said. I think it's an important question to ask, because it's sort of like a, you know, the corollary is what, you know, well, aren't you just, you know, aren't you saying that the things you say you value don't really mean that much to you? If you say you value justice and you value knowledge, then why do you agree to follow someone who's neither just nor knowledgeable? And, you know, isn't that hypocrisy? I think my answer would be yes, but, and again, my argument would be the Sunni, kind of the Sunni political contribution is that we live in a world of hypocrisy. Not in the sense that it's a, you know, we're all hypocrites and nothing means anything, but in the sense that human beings will get in profound disagreements and they will still have to deal with one another and agree on other things. They'll have to put their hurt aside, their feelings aside. They'll have to forget about injustices at some point and move forward. And that, it, we will mostly be led by people who are neither knowledgeable nor just, because the people who have guns or swords are very infrequently the most knowledgeable and just amongst us. And that at a certain point, the ability to live in peace and to have your family go to the mosque and pray and go to school and learn and sit and eat with your friends in peace and not fear death, not fear random acts of violence, at a certain point, that stability is much more important than having justice reign around you. What, you know, Sultan Rashum Khairu min Fitnatin Tadum, as Ghazali said. I know this is a Persian saying as well in the Persian tradition. An impressive sultan is better than strife that never ends. Yeah, food, it's important.
Yeah.
This gentleman had a question. You already asked a question. He has a question. Oh, you mean the sort of Sunni attitude towards government and power? So when confessional ambiguity is it's a really specific technical term. I think it's Marshall Hodgson who introduces this term. And it's specific to, it's particularly used in the context of kind of Anatolia, Iraq, and Iran in the kind of larger historical sense of Iran, in the from the 1200s to the 1500s, where you, or the early 1500s, where you basically have, it becomes very difficult to tell who's Sunni and who's Shiite, because you have a ruler on one side of the coin, they'll have Sunni slogans, on the other side of the coin, they have Shiite slogans. Literally, they're Sunnis technically, but their veneration for the family of the Prophet is so extreme that it almost seems Shiite. So that's what I mean by confessional ambiguity. And it's there's certain periods of confessional ambiguity in Islamic history in certain places that are pronounced, sort of Anatolia through Iran from the 1200s to the 1500s, I think is a good example. And you can see this with a scholar like Jalal ad-Din Devani, who dies around 1503, 1502, who's the kind of last big Sunni scholar of Iran, Sunni theologian of Iran, from Shiraz, or from Kazirun, near Shiraz. And in Shiite scholars, even writing, I think Shustari, writing just a few decades after the death of Devani, he talks about how Devani became Shiite at the end of his life. Sunnis don't accept that. But when you're trying to figure out, did he become Shiite or not, at a certain point you realize it's almost impossible to tell, because the way he's talking about the Imams or the family of the Prophet could be either Sunni or Shiite. It doesn't, especially in his time and place, it was a common language of veneration. So that's what I mean by confessional ambiguity. I guess that was the last question. Thanks very much, folks.